Hello everyone, my name is Ricky. Welcome to the Dev Method. So in the last couple of weeks, maybe a month or so, I've been looking into a new programming language called Rust. So I thought I'd share some of the stuff that I learned about it. So why am I making this video? I think it's good to learn something new. It can expand your mind in ways that you never thought were possible before. Another thing is that it could help you learn other programming languages, and it could also help you learn the languages you already know better than what you do now, because you get these ideas from one programming language, how do you translate it into another? So I think that that's cool. There's a couple of things in here that I learned that are not like the languages that I know from before. And I also was really curious because I can hear that, or at least I hear a little bit of talk of Rust replacing some C or C++ programming. So I thought that was interesting because those languages are pretty challenging to learn. And I thought if something was maybe easier or something was maybe more helpful, like what I'm finding in Rust, then it might be worth looking at. So how to follow along with some of these videos that are coming up here. There is a Rust programming book. It's on the Rust Lang website. I'll have a link in the description so you guys can follow along. Might be good to read the chapter first, then watch the video, or watch the video and then read the chapter, or just watch the video, or just read the book. It's totally up to you. However, which way you want to do it, that's up to you to decide. So what we'll do is we'll walk through all the different sections of the book. Well, at least most of them. I'll try and summarize. I'm not going to go through word by word. But I'll at least pick out the parts that I think are interesting, and then I'll also not only summarize what I've learned, but maybe even add some commentary as it relates to maybe other programming languages. So one of the first things that I take away from all this up front is that there's a lot of things in Rust that are very similar to Swift. So some of the other videos I've done are Swift related. I thought it'd be interesting maybe to do sometimes a side-by-side comparison, or at least just call out some of the things that I know from one language and how it relates to the other. There are not as many other similarities between this and TypeScript and JavaScript, but when they do come up, I'll try and point those out as well. So to get us going, I'm gonna assume that you already have the installation ready to go, that you're already done with that. There's installations for Linux, macOS, and Windows. It was pretty easy to follow just on the website. Again, it's in the book on how to do it, and it's also on the website, so you can read that. I'll be running a lot of the commands from the command line, and this would be similar to Linux because I'm on a Mac, but the Windows ones I think are almost exactly the same. You'll have to double check with me on that. And then there are various VS Code extensions to help you program, but I'm not gonna be using any of those just as an FYI. I'm gonna try and use the command line as much as possible for checking errors and such. There will be some squiggles that come up for like spell checking, but you know, maybe I turn that off, I don't know. So the first thing is making your project directory. So I'm just gonna pull up the command line here and I'm gonna get into my development folder. And we're just gonna do a very simple program. And so the first thing I'm doing here is making a directory, and I'll call it example. And then I'll cd into that directory. And I'm just gonna reload this current window of VS Code with this project directory open. So there on the left-hand side, you can see there are no files. So let's make one. I'm gonna do just main.rs. So rs are the files that we use for Rust. Those are your source files. That's where we write all the code. So here it is. I'm gonna write a very simple hello world program, and then we'll walk through actually like what's going on a little bit later. So fn main, mistyped there, here we go, and hello world, like so. Okay, my program, first program in Rust is written. So fn stands for function, so after this is going to come the name of the function, and this one is called main. It's very special because it's in the main.rs file, so that is absolutely required to make sure that this program runs. There are parentheses here. This is would be where parameters of a function go, but right now there are no arguments or parameters, so it's just empty. And then we have an opening and closing curly brace. You can see it here highlighted in yellow there. And everywhere in between, that's where our function definition goes, or the function implementation. So the first thing we write is println, or you might want to think of it as short for print line. And then it has an exclamation point. This you can think of as like a function. And then this does have an argument. We're giving it a string, so it's wrapped in double quotes, and we're just saying hello world. The last thing we want is our semicolon to end the line or end the statement. So the idea here that this println, we're going to use this a lot for printing out to the console so we can see what value there is, or what's the, you know, what's inside of a variable. And we'll do some other various things with strings here too. But strings are a little bit more complicated than you normally might see in something like, well, I guess they could be complicated in other languages too. But definitely in JavaScript, strings are, I guess, fairly simple. And there's a couple different ways to write strings here, but that's because some of the Rust syntax and some of its capabilities are a little bit more sophisticated. So we'll see that. But we'll see that down the line. So that's hello world. Now we close it off and then we're done with the program. So I'm going to pull up the command line again. And I am just going to compile this program. So we use something that came with Rust. It's called rustc. That's the compiler. And then you put in the name of the file. So main.rs. And that's the only argument. That will compile the application into a binary executable. So that binary executable is just main, no file extension. And if we do ./main to run it, we'll see hello world. So that's our example. That's the first step. There are other things that you could use in Rust. For example, I'm not really sure if this works, but let's just say there's Rust FMT for format and then the file name. Whoops, put the wrong file name. So Rust FMT and then the file name. And that formatted the code. So that's cool. You can run that if you want. See how it formats. So that's our first program. That was very simple, but we're going to want to add multiple files. So multiple, maybe functions, or we're going to have all sorts of different variables. We're going to put them all into one and then run them in main. We're going to reference them and call them. We're also going to want to use some stuff that Rust gives us out of the box. And you can think of these as like the standard library. There's other libraries out there too. So let's just take a moment and get set up in a more formalized project, something that's going to help us with project structure and help us with our project growing into the future. It's also something you'll see in all the different chapters that is used a lot. So let's get to it. So let me remove this folder here. I'm going to actually make a brand new one. There's another utility here that came with Rust when you installed it, and it's called cargo. So cargo is going to be in charge of grouping all of these files together. So we're going to use cargo some and then some other command to perform an action. So the first one we'll use is cargo new, and then we'll do hello_example. So what that does is it creates a directory like we did before, but now it's actually created it as like a package. And these packages are referred to as crates. And if you go to crates.io, you can find a whole bunch of other packages that you might want to use in your project. It's also a place where you can publish your own crate. So that's why using cargo is really beneficial here, because if you want to share this code in the end, you're going to want to do this. So let me go into this directory, and then I'll reload VS Code, at least this window, and we'll see where we're at. So it actually gave us a Git repository so we could do some version control. And it also gave us this cargo.toml file. And that's basically it. There is a source directory which has another main.rs, and it was just given there for us. But looking at this toml file, let's just start on line one. This is the package section. So the package section is going to be like information of configuration for the project. And then we have dependencies. So those are going to be where you can declare other crates or other libraries that you want to use in your project. So that will be used in a little bit as well in a different video. But that's essentially all we have. So if we go to the main.rs file here, you'll see that we have the same, almost the same thing that we've written before. Now, in order to get this project actually running, we're going to go back to the command line. So a couple of things that we could run right now, and we're at the root of our project here. We did rustc, so we don't have to do that anymore. Cargo knows about the file structure here. So what we're going to use is actually cargo build. We'll see what kind of output we get. So from there, notice it says like unoptimize plus debug info in targets. So if you look back at the files that have been created or generated, there's actually now a targets directory. This target directory will be ignored by your version control. But one thing to note about it is that it actually has your executable in there. So there's that hello underscore example, and that's the executable. So if I was able to run build, that means the compiler ran and it did a check. And then it said, okay, well, are there any other parameters to build that we provided? And that was no. So that's how it knew to do this like unoptimized build. There's more about configuring builds and stuff that we might get into a little bit later, but right now this is as much as you need to know. So the first thing it did was that check, that compiler check. So that's actually another command that we can run. And this took about, it says 0.85 seconds. That's not that long, but as projects grow, that gets longer and longer to build. There is some sort of incremental building that's going on. That's why the debug info is there. But just to give you an idea of what else you could use, there's cargo check, and this just checks as the compiler runs through the source code and sees if everything satisfies all of the compiler. So there it is. There's the check. And let me just run this one more time. Notice the second time I ran it, same thing as if we did build, it would see that there's no differences in the files, and then it would just give the output right away. So it was actually a lot faster to run the second time. But if I change something here, like add two of these, now I run the build command again. There it is. So it was incremental, so it didn't have to build absolutely everything from scratch. So that is the cargo check and the cargo build. The last thing that I want to show you is, well, what if you're ready to go to production? So if that's the case, you're ready to release something, you could actually do cargo build, but then dash dash release. So this is actually an optimized build. And what this does is it creates another target just like before. If we look in our targets directory, we have the debug directory, and then we have the release directory. So that release is now an optimized binary version with no debug information. So the thing that we're going to do is to run this, we actually can use a command called cargo run. So cargo run actually right now, just see it here. There it is. It actually looked at the debug one. So that's how we're using this on the command line just to test things out. And there it is, hello world twice, because that's how I did both of them. So now if I change the source file and I just want to run it again, I could actually just jump straight to cargo run. So this skips doesn't skip these steps, but we don't have to type in cargo check, then cargo run. We could just do, or cargo build. We could just do cargo run. So cargo run. So build it, and that's it. So thanks for watching the video. If you guys have questions, as always, leave them in the comments below and I can try and help you out the best that I can. And if there's something specific that you guys have questions about with the Rust programming language or something else, just let me know. And thanks for watching. Have a good one.